Yes, you are. Everybody say you are good.
You are good. All the time.
All the time. All the time.
All the time. You are good.
You are good.
You are good. All the time.
All the time.
All the time.
You are good.
You are good.
All the time.
All the time.
You are good.
You are good.
You are good.
All the time.
Good morning, Hope's House, and thank you for watching with us this week. Here are your weekly announcements. Join us this Wednesday for midweek at 7:30 p.m. on Facebook Live. If you would like to lead a connect group, please contact info@hopeshouse.com. The study is 8 weeks long and virtual via Zoom. Together, let's experience God and live for more. Calling all men. You've attended conferences and fellowships before, but you've never been to an event like this. Join Pastor Charles Humphrey and Elder Eric Claiborne for our first ever Kingdom Men's Huddle event. It's part conference, part fellowship, and 100% God. So clear your schedule, invite a brother, and join us for this two-day event. Register now on the app or by clicking the link in our IG bio. We're partnering with the Dream Center's foster care intervention team and throwing a Christmas bash for some awesome families. You'll get the chance to decorate, wrap gifts, and more. Lunch will be served. Please register on the app or head to the link on our IG bio to join us. We also invite you to help us collect items to bless these families. If you're able, here are some items to donate: shampoo and conditioner, toothpaste, hairbrushes, soap, and lotion.
Morning, Hope's House. Good morning to everyone who is here in the building. Good morning to everyone who is online, or good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are in the world. Would you all stand with me? We're going to pray before we enter into a time of acknowledging how awesome and great God is. So God, we thank you for another day that was not promised to us, God. We recognize how much of a miracle it is just us being alive this morning. We thank you, God, for that. We thank you, Lord, for all of the people who are here today, all the people who are watching service online, God. And I thank you in advance for the ways that you're going to meet them and the ways that you're going to speak to them, the seeds that you're going to plant in them, in their hearts and in their minds today, God. And I thank you that no one will leave this service the same way that they came in, God. We acknowledge today how awesome and how great you are, how powerful you are, God, and that there is nothing too hard for you, God. As we look at what's going on in our lives, we recognize that there's nothing too big for you, nothing too hard for you, nothing that you can't overcome, God. And I pray a prayer of overcoming over everyone in this building today and everybody who is watching at home. I pray a prayer of joy over you. I pray a prayer of healing over you. I pray a prayer of comfort over you, of community over you, of forgiveness over you. And I pray a prayer of love over you today. God, I thank you for everything that you're doing in the lives of everybody who is watching this service today, God. I thank you that you see them, that you know them, that you know every hair on their head, and you have a plan for them, Lord. And so we thank you, God. We lift you up in this place today. We give you the praise that you deserve, knowing that we can't give enough, God. We give you everything in this place today. And we thank you for all that you are giving us, God. We thank you for all that you've already given us. We thank you for your love for us that is unmatched. And we ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. My invitation to you is to look at God today. Look at him. Look to him for what you need.
You shine
into the dark.
sing, our God is greater.
Who can stop the Lord?
Our God is Victory every time. I know what those problems look like, but you win the victory every time. You bring home the win every time, and you do it for me. So thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You're worthy, God. You're worthy.
Stripes, we are healed. By his nail-pierced hands, we're free. And by his blood, we're washed clean. And now we have the victory.
Can you see the power of sin?
The power of sin is broken. Jesus overcame me all.
You are the answer, God. You have won our freedom, God.
Jesus won our freedom.
Jesus
has won it all.
It all.
You are the reason.
Dancing high.
Only you have won it all.
You've won it all for me. Even death could not hold you down. That's a miracle. 'Cause you are the risen King. Jesus, the only one, you're seated in majesty. Because I know you are the risen King, I can't help but bow down before you and come before you humbly, God. I can't help but acknowledge how awesome you are and how I am not worthy, Lord. But every day you meet me and you love me. Every day you come to me and you want to spend time with me, God. I can't help but acknowledge how you put the heavens together, God, and the earth, all that is within it, God, and you still see me, Jesus. So I can't help but give you all the glory, Jesus. I can't help but give you all the praise, Jesus.
Sincerely hope you're not tired of saying that over and over again. Because having been in the praise and worship environment for many of my years in ministry, there's this debate about whether you should sing like hymns and liturgical songs and things that have, you know, Rock of Ages and A Mighty Fortress of Our God. And then this new wave of Christian praise came along and people said it's too repetitive. It's the same old thing over and over again. I love you, Jesus, you know. I worship and adore you, you know, or worthy, or hallelujah. But when I read the Bible in the book of Revelation, it talks about night and day. The 24 elders take off their crowns and they say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And then they wake up the next day and say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And then on Saturday comes along and says, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And on their worst day, they say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And when things are going good, they're saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And on their worst day, they're saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. No matter what the circumstance looks like, doesn't matter what I feel in my body, he's still worthy, 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 yes, he is. Hey.
You are worthy to be praised.
I search the world over and I can't find no one worthy like you, Lord. You are worthy, 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 Lord.
You are worthy to be praised.
In my heart and soul, I know that you're worthy, Lord God. Yeah. My circumstance don't match my confession, but you're worthy of praise. My situation doesn't match what I believe in God for, but you're still worthy to be praised. My money situation hasn't lined up with what heaven says it should, but you're still worthy to be praised. I've got some pains in my body in places that I shouldn't have, but you're still worthy to be praised. Listen, my spouse is not acting the way I think they should act, but you're still worthy to be praised. I sure wish the pandemic was over, but you're still worthy to be praised. I'm tired of showing my ID and my vaccination card. You're still worthy to be praised. I just need some people to recognize today and acknowledge before God that in spite of what you're experiencing right now, you are still worthy to be praised. Come on, I need some help in here because I need us to help me help you help us. Come on, you're still worthy, still worthy, still worthy, still worthy. Yeah, yeah, yeah. The Dow Jones goes up and down, but you're still worthy. My boss acts sometimey, but you're still worthy. Yeah, yeah. My bunion be acting when the weather get bad, but you're still worthy, Jesus. Come on. Pastor Ray, I need a theological understanding. I think worship is the key to our consistency. Because we don't worship him for what he does. We worship him for who he is. And the Bible tells me, my God changes not. Is that theologically correct? Yeah, he doesn't change. So if he doesn't change, that means he's still worthy. He said, and you'll find that your mountains won't be so high and your valleys won't be so low if you stay in a place of worship. If you acknowledge every day With gratitude, God, you're still worthy to be praised. The fact that I have breath to praise you is a reason to know that it's going to be all right. Come on, come on. We got more going for us than we give him credit for. We got more on our side than we think sometimes. One last time, you're still worthy. Come on, just tell him to yourself. Tell him yourself. You tell God. Tell him. God, you're, thank you, Lord God. Thank you for waking me up this morning. Thank you, my wife still loves me. Hallelujah. Thank you, my dog still licked me when I come in the door. Come on. Thank you, my kids are still in their right mind. Thank you. Thank you, Lord God. My bank account isn't totally perfect, but you're still working in my behalf, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. I've got air conditioning. I got heat and the cold in the winter and air conditioning in the summer. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord, with a thankful heart, with an adoration. It's our response to you. It's our response to you, not the response to the circumstance. That's the consistency. It's our response to you. It's our response to you. You're worthy, worthy, worthy to be praised. God, we praise you in this place. We acknowledge you in this place. We can't thank you enough in this place. And we owe you everything in this place. You're still worthy to be praised. We bless your name, Lord God. For every person under the sound of my voice and those watching online, we declare blessing is not only coming, but blessing is realized in our hearts. We recognize the blessing's already come. Because when Jesus Christ died on the cross, he paid the price for everything that was jacked up in my life. And I thank you, Lord God. You deserve all the praise and all glory. Come on, you trying to go there for real? Thank you, Jesus. Y'all up today? Come on, yeah, my hand. Come on, let it
go. You are the source of my strength.
Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Yes, you are.
And you are the strength of my life. And I live my head to toe to praise you.
Keep your hands lifted in this hour. God is doing something in your life. He's doing something because you were willing to say thank you this morning. He's doing something because you were willing to come into his house and give him the proper praise he is due. Now, can we just say amen to this? Can we establish this worship in the earth with an amen? with a yes it is. Yes it is so. Yes it will be. Whatever that thing is that you're hoping for. Yes it will be. Amen. Your worship. I know it's a little different, but lift up your worship. Lift up your gratitude. Lift up your thank you. Lift up your thank you, Jesus. Lift up your thank you, Jesus. Woo! Hey, if it's breath in your body,
bless your name, Lord God. Bless your name, Lord God. Father, in this place, thank you for stirring something up. Stirring something up that was always down on the inside. And that's our worship. That's our worship that you deserve every day of our lives. God, and even relight the fire of worship in lives that have forgotten, Lord God. Rekindle the fire of worship, your personal worship, your personal, passionate, crazy, out of control, outside the box worship for the one who loves you and gave himself for you. Restore that in the lives, I pray, of every believer in this place in Jesus Christ's name. God, let us be hungry for your presence, hungry for your presence, desperate for more of you, Lord God, in this place, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You can have your seats if you can in the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I don't want you to forget what God is stirring up in you right now. Don't forget. Thank you, worship team. Thank you, band. Thank you, Jesus. Create a space. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Father, as we enter into this time of studying your word right now, we're declaring, Lord God, that you meet us at the point of our need, and we ask that you meet each person here at the point of their need, their very specific need that they have, Lord God. Meet them there, we ask in Jesus Christ's name. We don't want to manufacture anything. We don't want to try to recreate something. We want to ask that you do something unique today for the people who are calling upon your name, for those who are seeking your face, those who are looking for answers, Lord God. Meet them at the point of their need. Father, give me grace to be a yielded vessel at this time. I know I have a bunch of notes, a bunch of things I think are clever and cute and all that stuff. It don't matter, Lord God. Do what you want to do today, we ask in Jesus' name. All God's people said amen. Amen. All God's people said amen. What's up, Hope's House? Woo! I see you. Listen, we're going to jump right into this thing. I'm going to tell you guys right now, I'm a little undercover jealous because Pastor Dre and Pastor Ray got up there, had a little tag team situation up here last couple of weeks. I was going to get me one of those mannequins and just have it sitting right here. Like, okay, what you think? they did a fantastic. Let's give them a hand for the job they did, just breaking down those traditional things. Thank you. I am surrounded by people more talented than me. And I thank God that he allowed me to be in this space with these amazing ministers of God's word. And all you guys are amazing. I mean, turn to your neighbor and say, yeah, you're amazing. I know, I'm amazing too. That's right. Because God don't make no junk, huh? I'm amazing in God. We're going to see amazing today in Jesus' name. So, get ready to be amazed. Listen, turn your Bibles to the book of Mark, chapter 7. We're going to kind of finish this book out. Pastor Dre and Pastor Ray talked about those traditions of men. That how many folks identified some potato chip moments in your life last week? Some gateway drugs that led you off the pathway of righteousness. It's a joke, but it's real, ain't it? It's real. It's really real. So, praise God. We believe we overcome by the blood of the Lamb. Amen. I'm reading from Matthew 7, verse 24 through 30 in the New King James Version. It reads as follows. From there he arose and went to the region of Tyre and Sidon, and he entered a house and wanted no one to know it. But he could not be hidden, for a woman whose young daughter had an unclean spirit heard about him, and she came and fell at his feet. The woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician by birth, and she kept asking him to cast the demon out of her daughter. But Jesus said to her, "Let the children be filled first, for it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs." And she answered and says, wait, y'all got a while already? Come on now, this is the word of God, come on. But Jesus, and she answered him and said to him, "Yes, Lord, yet even the little dogs under the table eat from the children's crumbs." Then he said to her, "For this saying, go your way, the demon has gone out of your daughter." And when she had come to her house, she found the demon gone out and her daughter lying on the bed. Now, based on the little reaction I got just now, how many of y'all, when y'all first heard this story, Vacation Bible School, Old School Church, Baptist Church, Methodist Church, you were triggered by the way Jesus came at this woman who was simply asking for help? How many folk had a little attitude, a little something, for real? Or y'all just believe God's word? God said it, I believe it, there he is. See, there are those who may be of, we live in a place of great intersectionality and the need for diversity and inclusion is at an all-time high, and it's a good thing. But in this case, it sounds kind of like he's talking down to her, and it could be construed as racist or misogynistic or, if nothing else, insensitive. This woman is crying out for help, and you're like, but the dogs. And that's all you heard was dogs. Ladies, sometimes your man be saying something, all you heard was a negative thing. My wife plays with me sometimes. Sometimes I say some stupid stuff. But one time, anyway, she played. So you're calling me a what? Have you ever done that? So you said it looked like, anyway, huh? I'm gonna just keep on going. So I wanna keep my marriage intact, praise the Lord. But listen, sometime when you hear this story, certain words trigger us, don't they? Certain words trigger us, don't they? And they get our attention. And as a result of our culture, which is now turned in a lot of ways into this cancel culture, y'all want to cancel Jesus based on this. I know nobody here because you love the word of God so much and whatever God says is pure to you. But this one kind of stung a little bit. Jesus, dang, Jesus, for real? You had to go there, the dog situation. If you were following Jesus on social media, and you saw this on your timeline, you're like, okay, let me unfollow this cat. Let me delete this cat. If he's sitting in your DMs to my dog, you might like, let me block him. Yeah, it's almost like, you know, there are some people who love Colin Kaepernick when he was in the Super Bowl for the 49ers, but once he took a knee, they decided to burn his jersey. Love the game, love the team, but that kneeling thing, that's unpatriotic. How dare you? Oh, God, I'd burn his jersey. Or even burn an image of him in effigy. See, this cancel culture is pretty strong. And I think that if we, as believers, don't find a way how to negotiate through it and see God in it and see God around it, we will be canceling stuff left and right that God has assigned for your life. See, this lady, she didn't cancel Jesus. The Bible says she said, okay, yeah, I see you. Whatever you said, but Y'all ever use that but? I know you use it when you don't want to do something. I know I should go to church, but. No, you need to use it in a good way. She used her butt in a good way. She. Edit that out. See, I told y'all I'd be saying some stuff. My wife is cringing right now. She's like, okay, read the scripture, Pastor. Anyway, so my question to you is this. How did come back in Jesus' name? Amen. Amen. We was just in his presence too. How did this woman resist the temptation to be offended at what Jesus said and get her blessing? That's the real question. I'll say it again. How did this woman resist the temptation to be offended at the way he treated her? You know, these days, you can't, don't touch me. You in my space. We all got so many rights that we're trying to enforce on a regular basis. And it's our fighting for the rights which causes things to escalate. And things get out of control because, and you know, this in marriage, it wasn't the issue of, we had this discussion this morning, whether you put the toilet paper on the roll forwards or backwards, right? Or under or over, which causes great debate. How many folk are under people? Under you? Y'all ain't gonna testify today? Okay, forget y'all. Leave me out here by myself. So I put the roll on the toilet paper roll under to pull under, and my wife says that's the wrong way to do it. We got a fight before church. I don't know. We didn't have a fight. She just pointed out to me that I do it wrong. No, but listen, some of y'all are dead set that this is the way it should be done. Some of y'all have a strong opinion, about what's right and wrong, which goes back to tradition, doesn't it? Well, you got some traditions that you have erected in your life, and you want to impose them upon everybody else. And there is no right or wrong way in many cases in the Bible. But listen, I want to get back to my point. How did she get past the temptation to be offended by how the toilet paper was rolled on the roll or how the dishwasher was loaded? How did she get past that to get her blessing? Is there a whole bunch of situations, right? I want to say in simple terms, she was desperate. She was desperate. And I want to call this message Driven by Desperation in our Making Your Mark series. So if you want to make your mark in Christ, sometimes you have to be desperate. Be desperate like this woman was. That nothing else matters except the goal and the intention that is before you. Nothing else matters. In this case, her desperation was because her young daughter was being tormented by a devil. She couldn't take it no more. She had to do something about it. It didn't matter. And I want to give you this example because we have gone through situations like this woman in our natural history as African Americans or Latinos or minorities or underprivileged or underserved, whatever you want to call it. And I'll just take you back to the Jim Crow South. If you were, I think Jackie Robinson is a good example because he's playing Major League Baseball. He was the star of their team. But if he went to the Jim Crow South, he couldn't use the white water fountain. He couldn't use the white bathroom, even though he was this great, amazing athlete who brought in hundreds and thousands of dollars for his team and was a national hero in baseball. He still had to recognize, boy, you better go and use the bathroom in the back. This is not the time to fight for your rights. Go relieve yourself, get back on the bus, and pray you don't get shot or hung. Stay focused. And see, we pick fights and battles over stupid stuff these days. Because we're not afraid of getting shot or hung. Well, let me take it back. Ahmaud Arbery, yeah. Breonna Taylor. Anyway, but we have to be desperate and focused on the goal. And sometimes we have to swallow our pride. Sometimes we have to take some abuse. Sometimes we have to go out of our way and be inconvenienced to get the thing that we need in God. And I want to attack this spirit that's among Christians that we can just have it our way whenever we want to have it. You know, praise God, I have Pastor Ray on social media. I've got Pastor Dre on my Instagram. I've got Hope's House website. I don't have to come to church. And there's this malaise and this indifference and this, what's the word? Complacency that comes upon us because we have so many options. So many options. We ain't desperate no more. I remember my first Bible, Pastor Ray, that I really got when I was really reading the Bible, like really discovering what it said. The pages are jacked up. The pages are marked up. the pages are yellow and scratched up and notes everywhere and everything, and now I can just swipe. I may, you know, just listen to it by audio feed, you know. But there was a time I was desperate to get in God's word, man. I'm talking for myself. May not be y'all, but I'm talking about me. That you craved, you were hungry. As Les Brown said, you got to be hungry, right? Hungry for God's word. And we've gotten to this place because we have so many conveniences and so many options and so many choices. I don't catch church on Sunday. I'll catch Pastor Ray's midweek next week. And I'll catch Pastor Ray's first of the month next month. If I'm in my car and it's convenient, nobody's in my car talking to me and I want to listen to the radio show. Come on, people. Where's the desperation for God? We just sang, you are worthy of praise. See, I thank you for wherever that song came from. Yeah, because it's saying I'm responding to God, man. You're worthy. I could be in a jacked up situation, but you're still worthy. And there's a response to God that many of us have had when we were in desperate times, didn't we? We had a response to God like Jesus. You didn't care who was around. You didn't care who was watching. You didn't care who was snapping pictures. You didn't care, you know. I think we used to have a disclaimer on the door that you may be filmed, all that kind of stuff. And who's going to see me? And in the old days, you came down to the altar, didn't you? And confessed your sins. Now it's like, everybody's head bowed, everybody's eyes closed. And if you feel like you want to, possibly need to, possibly raise your hand, lift it, kind of wave, blink your eye at me. Blink your eye if you want to get saved. As opposed to going down to the water to get baptized, knowing that persecution awaited you for your call for Jesus Christ. It's not in my notes. This is the Holy Spirit. Okay, so she was desperate, driven by desperation. My subtitle is, I Need My Space. Driven by desperation. If you're in desperate situations, we need our space. Let's explain a little further. So desperate, what does it mean? Desperate is reckless or dangerous because of despair or urgency. Having an urgent need or desire. Having little or no hope. Very serious or dangerous. Actuated by a feeling of hopelessness. So there's good desperation and bad desperation. See, bad desperation really leads you to make bad decisions. You heard the term, desperate people do desperate things, all right? And sometimes people let their desperation lead them to bad decisions. The teenager who's desperate to get out of their parents' household sometimes runs away and they find themselves in a worse situation, being sexually trafficked, prostituted, or living on the streets. Kind of like the prodigal son. He was desperate to leave home. He didn't plan to be in a pig pen. But his desperation made him make a bad decision. And other things. Sometimes the lonely woman who's desperate for love will find herself hooked up with the wrong guy who's abusive. And you find yourself balancing, but he gives me attention, but he does hurt me, but he does give me attention, but he does speak to me like a dog, and he gives me attention, but what will I do if I'm not with somebody? And see, desperation manifests itself in different ways. The young man who's trying to make money and get ahead and make his mark in life, he may be desperate to make money, and he'll go out and compromise and start selling drugs, and then find himself with the wrong crowd, and find himself in jail, and find himself wondering why he is in a situation that's worse than what he was when he was working at Taco Bell. See, desperation takes on different forms. It can be a bad thing. Desperate people do desperate things. Desperation also often leads to bad decision-making. Desperation often leads to despair and destructive behavior. But there is a desperation that you guys are a little more familiar with because we are in a social media generation. And we see people on social media who seem to be desperate. I know y'all got a word called thirsty that you use. She's so thirsty. He must be thirsty. All his posts are like duck lips, half naked, in the bed, looking at the camera, asking me some questions. How do I feel? Some people just have their thirst all over the social media platform. Nobody in the Church of God of Jesus Christ, but some people that we know have these way of expressing their desperation, and it's unhealthy. Let me talk to the men. Y'all, it's not just for women, men too, because y'all be desperate too. Problem with men is that sometimes they're desperate and they don't express it. So we have this quiet desperation underneath the surface. This quiet desperation, looking for love, looking for answers, looking for solutions. This quiet desperation that leads them to boil over at a point, and it comes out in some catastrophic way. I can't speak for all the serial killers. I can't speak for all the people who shoot up audiences. I don't know what their situation, but I guarantee there's some kind of desperation in there somewhere that something needed to come out, and it came out with a shotgun or an AK-47, unfortunately. Or it came out punching a hole in the wall in your house or hitting your wife or your kids. It came out some kind of way. Or some kind of sexual deviance, but your desperation shows at some point or another. See, desperation is an everyday occurrence. People are desperate all the time. In fact, Bible people were desperate too. Yeah, the woman who had the issue of blood, she was desperate. And she, even though she was quote-unquote unclean at the time, she took a risk and pressed her way through the crowd to find Jesus and touch the hem of his garment. I remember in the Old Testament, there was this wrestling match going on between Jacob and this angel, and he says, I won't let you go until you bless me. He wasn't going to let go because he was desperate. In a good way, the man was focused. David, running from Saul. Oh, Lord, how are they increased that trouble me? Many there be that rise up against me. Many there be that say of my soul, there's no help for him in God. But thou, O Lord, are a shield for me, my glory, and the lifter of my head. He was desperate. And then you go back to Psalm 91. He was desperate when his sin was revealed that he was the one that Nathan exposed for sinning by killing the Uriah the Hittite. Uriah, and he was desperate to be forgiven of his renewing me a clean heart. Renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence. All I know is you, Lord. If you cast me away from your presence, I have nothing left. Desperate. So desperation is nothing new. How many folk been desperate? Once or twice, tell the truth, shame the devil. We all been desperate at some point in time. It's not a sin to be desperate. Pray for me. It's not a sin to be desperate. Just don't let your desperation cause you to sin. So before we cancel Jesus for his arrogant, demeaning, ungodly, insensitive commentary to this woman, let's look at this passage in the book of Matthew. This is another parallel situation where the story is recounted with this woman, Matthew 15. I'm going to read it in the Amplified Version really quickly. It says, and a Canaanite woman from that district came out and began to cry out urgently, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, son of David, Messiah. My daughter is cruelly possessed by a demon, but he did not say a word in answer to her. And his disciples came and asked him repeatedly, send her away because she keeps shouting after us. And Jesus answered, I was commissioned by God and sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. But she came and began to kneel down before him, saying, Lord, help me. And he replied, it is not good, appropriate, or fair to take the children's bread and throw it to the pet dogs. She said, yes, Lord, but even the pet dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the young master's table. Then Jesus answered her, woman, your faith, your personal trust and confidence in my power is great. It will be done for you as you wish. And her daughter was healed from that moment. So Jesus just finished dealing with these Pharisees, talking about traditions. These Pharisees followed him from Jerusalem to this outermost place to confront him about traditions of men. Then he goes to the region of Tyre and Sidon, roughly 100 miles away if you flew in a straight line from Jerusalem, right? And he's trying to get away from the crowd. He and the disciples rent this beautiful Airbnb on the coast. They're going to have a good time. Big screen TV, beautiful place, man. Big plate glass windows. You can see the whole oceanside, coastside. And this woman comes knocking at the door to Airbnb like, Jesus, you got to help me. I know you're trying to get away. I know you're trying to get away, but I don't care, basically. I don't care. My need is so great, I will disturb Jesus in his getaway at the Airbnb, okay? And some of y'all need to disturb Jesus sometimes. See, you're too nice. You like, You're like, well, I'll just tough it out, Jesus. No, call his name. Call his name, Lord. So she interrupts them, and she's not only, here's the deal, she is a Canaanite. They call it in the Bible in this passage, a Canaanite. She's a Syrian, a Phoenician. She's a Gentile. She's a woman. She's got a bunch of strikes against her. She's anything but Jewish. Anything but Jewish. Underserved, underrepresented, marginalized, all that stuff, right? So here she is asking Jesus. Let's check out the dialogue, okay? I think it helps us to see the dialogue. So the I call it the SPW, the Syrophoenician woman. She says, have mercy on me, O Lord. She calls him Son of David. These are magic words. To that time, to that date, the disciples never called him Son of David. To that time, the Pharisees never called him Son of David. They called him Master, Teacher, Rabbi, all that stuff. They didn't call him Son of David. Son of David is significant because that's the messianic title that traces his bloodline through David, and he has kingdom authority in the earth. He has heritage and lineage that says he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, okay? So she recognizes this. Interesting enough, there's some other folks who called him Son of David, too, in the Bible. Blind Bartimaeus, Son of David, by the side of the road, have mercy on me, right? Remember him? Yeah. A blind man and an underrepresented, under-marginalized person recognized who Jesus is, but the Pharisees and his own disciples didn't recognize he's Son of David. Something's wrong. I want to declare that there's some people who are not in the church who will recognize more about God that we miss on a regular basis because we're in our traditions and we're in our traditions of men. We have gotten in such a box that we don't recognize who he really is because we didn't sing the right song and you didn't preach the right way. You didn't hoop after the She addresses him by his messianic title, Son of David. She recognizes who he really is. Jesus' response was crickets. He didn't respond. He didn't say a mumbling word. This woman is shouting at you, blood-curdling screams, Jesus, help me, Son of David. My daughter is being possessed by a demon. Do something about the situation. What restraint? He don't say a word. Let's keep on with the conversation. Have you ever cried out to God and you didn't think he said a word? Have you ever cried out to God and he's like, crickets? And I mean, your baby is sick and you're like, God, please do crickets. God, I need, the rent is due like yesterday. And give me a sign, crickets. It can be debated whether God's testing us or who knows, but silence can be deafening sometimes when you're hoping the one who says, I will answer you speedily, actually answers you speedily. Seems like an eternity, doesn't it? When God is silent and you're crying out to God. There's nothing worse. David had this situation over and over again where he cried out to God and he said in Psalm 22:2, oh my God, I will cry in the daytime, but you do not hear. And in night season, I'm not silent. But my God, Job cried out to God. He wasn't just like watching video games and playing Fortnite. He was like, God, do something about this situation. His friends were not silent. But he's like, God, you're silent in this situation. My worst time, it seems that you're silent. God eventually breaks the silence for his glory. Let's follow the conversation. Jesus gives her crickets. Disciples say, send her away. She keeps shouting after us. Translation, we're trying to watch the game, Jesus. What's going on, man? Come on, close the door. They about to score. Can you pass me the chips, Peter? Note that the enemy will use those who are supposed to be helping you to silence you sometimes, won't they? The disciples are here trying to learn of Jesus, follow Jesus, be taught by Jesus, and do what Jesus did. They're like, send her away. Isn't that against our goals and our intentions? We want to bless people and help people. And the disciples are like, but we busy, we tired. Have you ever, listen, we've all been there. We come to church and we don't feel like serving. There's a need that comes our way and we don't feel like meeting the need. And you know God is tapping you on the shoulder and say, I need you to touch this person. Oh, Jesus, I'm watching a game. There's a shoe sale. It ends in 2 hours. I got to get to the mall. And God like, for real? For real? Well, next time you need something from me, I'll be at the mall. No, he doesn't do us like that, right? But the disciples show our human nature, because I've been there. People have needs. And I'm like, you know what? I really had planned to do X, Y, and Z, but send them away. Hope they go away. Don't answer the phone call. Put it on silent. Do not disturb. Anyway, following the conversation. So, disciples, they send her away. Jesus doesn't respond to the woman. He responds to the disciples. They say, send her away. Jesus, so it's as if Jesus is here, the disciples here watching the game, and the woman's out here like, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And so he turns to the disciples. He says, disciples, listen, I was only sent for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. I was commissioned by God for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So he explained his purpose. And that's one thing that comes out in this text, is his purpose is to minister to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. You know, Israel that was cutting up all the time, making golden idols and all that kind of stuff. That them folks, okay, who were called to be a light in the world about God and greatness and all that stuff. Yeah, I came to get them right. So he tells that to the disciples. She's still shouting, Jesus! Okay. So the Syrophoenician woman says, even as he's talking to his disciples, Lord, help me. Real simple, deep, heavy prayer, right? Remember Jesus walking on water, Lord, save me. Your prayer don't have to be long and lengthy and deep with Greek and Hebrew. Lord, help! He can hear that prayer. He can help. He can help. He can hear that prayer, okay? Simple prayer, Lord, help me. And it's almost as if Jesus is over there doing what he's doing. Disciples over here are trying to watch the game. And she's like outside, listen, help me, help me, help me. And she goes, positions herself around and begins to bow at the feet of Jesus. She bypasses the crowd. Some of y'all need to bypass the crowd of your lives and get to Jesus. What's holding you back from Jesus? Who is actually really in your way from you getting to Jesus? Who is standing between you and the living God? Is it a family? Is it friends? Is it your homies? Is it your expectations? Is it your persona on social media? What keeps you from going all out for God? She wasn't going to let nobody, all 12 of them jokers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, Jesus. She positions herself to worship. Now Jesus responds to her. Finally. It's not good or appropriate or fair to take the children's bread and throw it to the pet dogs. Let the children be filled first, for it's not good to take the children's bread and throw it to little dogs. So either Jesus is using a very strong metaphor, or he is actually calling her dog. Or is he calling the Gentiles dogs? See, the theory is that Gentiles were considered dogs. I did a little research on this. It's like there's kind of debate. I don't think Jesus called anybody else a dog in the Bible. Even people who, if we take the space, if we take the stance that Gentiles were considered dogs, anything that's not Jewish is considered a dog. If we take that stance, he didn't call the woman with the issue of blood a dog. She was a child. He didn't call the centurion who was a Roman who had a servant who was struck with a fever. He didn't call him a dog. He didn't call anybody else a dog. So he didn't call the woman at the well a dog. As thirsty as she was for water and for men, he didn't call her a dog. So why all of a sudden in this here situation we are, Jesus called her a dog? I think if you study the Bible, you don't see Jesus calling a person a dog. So I think he's making a very strong point. Can you flash my pictures? I got some pictures for y'all. And just to illustrate the point, just because you guys get this, but I want you to get it. You got my pictures? Okay, maybe not. Anyway, I had a picture of my daughters. Where are my people at? Are y'all up there? That's Wesley. That's one of my dogs. Love him. He loves us. He loves me scratch. Love me. In fact, if you come in the room, he sees you coming, he'll turn over like scratch my chest. And that's That's Max missing Lauren on Lauren's bed. As much as we love these dogs. that's the problem. We treat them like people anyway. Show the next picture. They do not compare with these two right here that my wife brought forth into earth. There is no way on God's creation, God's green earth, I would ever prioritize those dogs over those two beautiful daughters of mine. Never. Never. You couldn't pay me. You couldn't pay me to do it. Why? God's given me a responsibility, given us a blessing, and there's as much as people treat pets like family, it's still no comparison. So Jesus is not only clarifying his purpose, he's clarifying his priorities. Here's the key thing. You can take, you lead it up. You're beautiful. Embarrass my girl. He clarifies his purpose and clarifies his priorities. So he doesn't talk to her. He talks to the disciples about his purpose. He talks to her about his priorities. But listen, and my wife can relate to this because we used to play basketball a lot, and we appreciate Kobe Bryant. Sometimes Kobe Bryant would try to get into a space that didn't seem to be there, right? He'd try to split the defenders and go to the hole, and he would score. Oh, my gosh. I'm like, what are you doing? Oh, good play, right? You know, and my wife has the same attitude because Jesus may have implied, in a worst-case situation, she was a dog. Jesus gave her silence. The disciples gave her guff. Jesus gave her his priorities, but she never heard him say no. y'all didn't get that. She never heard him say no. What we do is we implant a no where there is none. Well, you know, I've been living in sin last few days, so God certainly can't bless me. Oh, I haven't really been in my Bible, so God really don't want to bless me with a new ministry or anoint me. I really haven't really been reading the scriptures or praying or seeking his face. So therefore, I'm saying no to the promises of God. When God says yes, the promises are yes and amen to you. And Jesus, when he addresses her, doesn't say no. Why are you saying no when Jesus don't say no? Jesus says, if you really want me, come on, find that crack through the defense and find your way to the hole and slam dunk that bad boy because I have a blessing for you. If you can push back what looks like resistance, if you can push back what looks like rejection, if you can push past what looks like dismissal, if you can push back what looks like I don't care about you, you can say, yeah, but you may not care about me, but I need this blessing so bad. Come on, y'all, do you get this? I'm trying to preach today that God is not saying no to you, even though you may have said in your mind, he's telling me no. What you've done is you combined the no's of your past, the no's of your parents, the no's of your problems, and said Jesus must be saying no too. He's not saying no to her. He leaves an open door for her to slide through, and she gets the blessing that she was desperate for. And desperation will cause you to hear a yes when the other people are saying no. Desperation will cause you to hear that God can when the world says God can't. Because you have no choice. I got no choice. The reason God moved in these desperate people's situations, the woman with the issue of blood, because she had no choice. Y'all talked about it. She spent all that she had on everything else. Her last chance and hope of any healing and deliverance was Jesus Christ. And she didn't say, I need him to come to my house and pay me a house visit or give me an hour of his counseling time. She said, if I can just touch the hem of his garment. She didn't give him a chance to say no. I don't know how. Y'all got to stop saying no to yourselves. Y'all got to stay. See, if you're desperate, you can't take no for an answer. But that's the problem. We're complacent. How you respect my rights? You put respect on my name. Listen, if you're desperate, the respect on your name is not as important as getting what you need from Jesus Christ. Well, I can't go down to the altar and wrinkle up my good satin dress. Are you serious with me right now? They might see me. not desperate then. E.T. the hip-hop preacher, Eric Thomas, great motivational speaker, has this signature about him wanting to be a success in business or life or as an entrepreneur. And he says, I go to see this guru on the seashore and say, how did you get successful? The guy says, meet me at the beach tomorrow morning. He says, the beach? Okay, he comes dressed with a suit, tie, briefcase, the whole bit. We're going to learn some business skills so I can be successful in business. The guru says, come follow me. Leads him down from the walkway to the sandy shore and starts walking the water. He said, what you doing? I want to know how to be successful. He said, yeah. Keep following me. He said, man, the water's cold. He said, you want to be successful? Keep following me. He keeps following the guy. Goes deeper and deeper and deeper in the water. And he goes to a deep place where he's up to his throat. And the guru grabs him by the head and plunges him under the water and holds him down. This is not a baptism. It's like he's trying to kill my black behind right up in here at Playa del Rey. The story goes that the guy puts his head down. He comes up gasping for air. What are you doing, man? I came to you trying to find a way to be successful in life. And here you are messing around on the beach, messed up my suit, messed up my briefcase, got me all wet, got me about to die. I'm about to kick your butt up in here. What are you doing? He pushes down again. Comes back a bit. What are you doing? What are you doing? You're crazy. The guru looks at him and says, listen, if you want to be successful, as bad as you want to breathe, then you'll be successful. You have to be desperate. You have to be desperate. You have to be desperate where it's life and death. There's no turning back, no plan B, C, D, E, F, G. It's on God or nothing. God or nothing. God, your way or no way. If you don't bless me, I'm just going to have to die, but I will not let you go if you don't bless me. So here's the points I want to give you from this desperate woman, that if you apply these to your life, no desperate situation will catch you being in a place of making bad, desperate decisions. I need my S-P-A-C-E. One, her desperation sparked determination. See, when you're a desperate mom, you're looking for answers. No mom wants to see their kids sick with a cold or the flu. When Sydney was young, we came back from Florida from a trip, and she was breathing hard on the plane, and she got home. We were giving her Advil and Tylenol, all this stuff. We didn't realize she had asthma. We got her to the hospital up here. They put her in immediately and gave her these breathing treatments, and she was healed. But at the moment, I would easily, gladly say, I will take my kid's place, right? Because they're in pain, they're sick. They don't understand, they can't process. She was like 2 years old, something like that, right? And they can't process what's going on. They don't know how to fight or stand or confess God's word, and you would gladly take their place. When you're desperate, you don't want to be sick, but you don't want them to be sick either. And your kids. Her desperation activated or sparked determination. She was determined to find an answer. That's the S. It's P. It pushed her toward Jesus. See, sometimes when we're desperate, we go away from Jesus Christ. We run to this ungodly solution. We run to the world. We run to our habit. We run to our vice. We run to our drama. We run to our boo. We run to our sugar daddy, whatever you want to call it. We run to something. Let your desperation push you toward Jesus, not away from him. That's P. A, it activated the cry of her heart. Her desperation activated the cry of her heart. And sometimes there's a worship inside you. There's a worship inside every one of you. If you're born again, there's a worship inside of you. But have you activated it? Have you activated the cry of your heart that says, God, I really want you. I need you. God says, in this situation, she was so desperate in a good way that it activated something inside her. There's a cry. Yeah, I don't know if you ever cried out to God, Lord, I need you now, right? You've cried out to God. And it wasn't a regular, oh, Lord, it's not a whine. It's not a complaint. It's a cry, a heart cry. It activated the cry of her heart. Lord, save me. Lord, help me. And then she pushed past the crowd of disciples who were eating chips and nachos, and she created her own place of worship. Listen, they're at the Airbnb, y'all. They're about to get away from the crowds, get away from all the drama, get away from all the people who need healing, and they've got to do their own thing. And she said, I don't care. This is not church service. Listen to me. This is not the cathedral. This is not the synagogue. I'm going to create my own place of worship. I'm going to get past the crowd and make a place at Jesus' feet and create a place of worship. Sometime you need to go on your job and create a place of worship. Sometime you need to, in your own home, create a place of worship. Sometime at your baby mama's house, create a place of worship. See, it's not going to happen by itself. It's not going to happen by itself. I wish people were more loving and more kind and worship more. No, you are called to be a worshiper. You can create a place of worship. You can create a place where God is honored and glorified and blessed. C, create a place of worship. And E, establish God's purpose and priorities. She agreed with God, and that's the best we can do. She looked at God and said, I see you have a purpose, and I see your priorities, but even the dogs can get a little something. Do you know my dogs, when we start going to the kitchen around 6 o'clock and cooking dinner, where my dogs at? They at attention while we're doing whatever they are at attention. And then if we go down and sit down and have our plate, guess where the dogs are? Why? They know they're getting some. They may not get nothing, but they got a history enough. They're like, I'm going to get something. I'm going to stare at you long enough, make you feel convicted enough. I'm going to just laser beam you, right? I'm going to get something. Don't I look cute? You can't resist my cuteness. Why do dogs understand if they just hang around the proximity of God's people? And the people of God don't understand hanging around the presence of God will get them blessings. You'll get blessings, you'll get the overflow of somebody else's blessing if you stay in God's presence. I don't know what to tell you, but you need to be desperate. I know things are convenient, and we're going to get out in less than an hour and a half. Praise God for that. But you still got to be desperate. I'm talking to myself. I come in here every now and again to pray in the house of God where nobody else is. I might pray upstairs in the dance room. I might pray out here. I go crazy. I'm like, yeah, if you saw the tape, you're like, what is he doing? That's my place to express myself to God. Create a space, guys. Quit limiting yourself to, well, I can't worship here. Well, I can't sing loud here. Well, I can't do that here. Well, they don't believe in the Bible. You better create a space, because the world is getting crazier and crazier, and it's going to displace your worship. This desperate woman looked past what was a perceived insult, whether it was or not. She did not care, because she was desperate for a solution that only Jesus could satisfy. I think that's what God wants to get us to. Yeah, we got rid of tradition. Wonderful. Now what you going to do? You still need desperation to make that thing work. Let's get past some traditions. Let's get past your limitations. Get past your box of where Jesus operates and say, listen, by any means necessary, I got to create my space. Create my space. Spark determination. Push toward Jesus. Activate the cry of your heart. Create a place of worship. Establish God's purpose and priorities. In Jesus' name. Stand to your feet. I want us just for a couple minutes just create a space. We just create a space for Jesus to be glorified. Create a space for Jesus to be magnified. Create a space. We don't have to wait for the worship team. Come on, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. We worship you right now. We honor you right now. We dedicate this time, this space, this 6-foot distancing, this 3-foot distancing, I dedicate it to you. I call you Abba Father. I call you my great Redeemer, the Lord, my Savior, my Yeshua HaMashiach. I call you the one who saved me and the one who rescued me. And I need you now. I need you now. I'm coming to church. I look good and I dressed up for the occasion, but I really need you in my life. I need you to deliver me from addictions and fears and impasses that I placed on myself. I need you to deliver me from a mindset that always sabotages the good things that you do in my life. I need you to deliver me in the midst of my family situation that is too much for me to handle, Lord God. I'm desperate for some answers. I'm desperate for solutions. emotions. I'm going to push past my pain. I'm going to push past my problems. I'm going to push back my preoccupations and begin to seek your face like I never had before. Because really, I've been in quiet desperation, but I got to express it, Lord God. And the best place to express it is to you, because you're the one who can really solve those problems. You're the one who can really fix my issues, Lord God. Just like the woman with the issue of blood, Lord God, you fixed her. If you can fix her, you can fix me. If you can fix a centurion who wasn't even a Jew, Lord God, you can fix me, Lord God. And I don't care what you call me, Lord God, as long as you accept me as your child, Lord God, as long as you receive me into your kingdom as your child, your very own, and don't turn me away, Lord God, I thank you that you answer me and you answer the cry of my heart. Help me create space. Help me create a space, Lord God, where my desperation can flow to ears that can hear and hands that can help, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. I choose to create a space when I'm distressed. When I'm distressed, and when I feel rejected, and when I feel like I'm nothing, and the world tells me I'm no good, and my mind says I'm no good, and my failures are flesh in my face once again, telling me what I've messed up, Lord God, I'm creating a space, Lord God, because I'm desperate, Lord God. I'm so desperate, Lord God. I love you, Lord God, more than anything. Thank you, Lord God. Come on, let's honor God. Come on, tell him. Say, I love you, Jesus. I'm desperate for more of you.
Just want to tell you, Lord, I love you more than
standing in the presence of God, you declared your love for Jesus. God, we ask that you cause that love, Lord God, to grow, that desperation, that response to you to grow more and more. Even when we leave this place, Lord God, cause the desperation to be so pronounced in our lives, Lord God, that we are seeking places and spaces to connect with you, to reach out to you, to call upon you, Lord God, to receive from you, Lord God, the very thing we need, Lord God. No more dismissing our needs, Lord God. We're crying out to you for the thing we have need of right now. Now, while you're standing and eyes are closed and heads are bowed, we want to ask in Jesus' name for those who are not saved. You know that you have not yet made a connection with Jesus Christ. You never yet asked him for the pardon of your sins or confessed him as Lord. If you just wave your hand at me, if you want to make a decision for Jesus Christ right now. Our brother has a card right now. If you have prayer requests right now, they have a card that you can scan the code and submit a prayer request. But if you want to make a decision for Jesus Christ today with boldness and recognize, yes, I'm desperate to know Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, you can come to the altar. We can pray with you in a safe way at the altar. We want to acknowledge your decision and have you acknowledge purposely in the presence of the saints your decision for Jesus Christ. Maybe here and you are wanting to rededicate your life. You haven't been in the Word. You haven't been coming to church regularly. You're here today just by circumstance or happenstance, but you need to get back in a place where you have a flow, a relationship, an ongoing dialogue with God, and really give your life to serve Him. And you're desperate to make a change and get back on track. You want to come down. We want to pray with you and pray for you. You can just come to the altar. We want to pray with you and just believe God with you for God to change things around in your life in Jesus' name. Desperation squashes fear. Desperation squashes ego. If you're here, you want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. For those who are online, you can call the number for any of those requests to be saved, to be filled with the Holy Spirit, to rededicate your life to Jesus Christ, even to join this church. Just call that number on the line. Our prayer counselors will answer you and minister to you and talk with you briefly to make sure they can help you in this situation. By all means, if you're desperate for prayer, we want to pray with you and pray for you. If you have a desperate situation in your life, whatever it is that you call a desperate situation, just wave your hand at me real quick. Wave your hand. Wave your hand. Wave your hand. Amen. We want to pray. We want to pray. We want to pray. We want to pray. Can I, we have time? Can I ask them to come down? Just while you have your hand in the air. Have your hand in the air. I want those around you just reach your hands toward them. Reach your hands toward them. We're going to pray for them in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. Father, we touch and agree by faith, Lord God, with every hand that is raised in Jesus Christ's name. We ask that you be the God that answers the desperate cry of the person who is calling your name right now. We ask that you answer the desperate cry of the person who has a family situation or an addiction situation or a financial situation or a personal image situation, Lord God. They're in a loop of confusion or a place where they don't know which way to go, what to do. But all they know is, all they know that their desperation is pushing them towards you, Lord God. Their desperation is pushing them towards you. And we're asking right now that you hear the humble cry, Lord God. Hear the humble cry, Lord God. As the psalm says, don't pass them, gentle Savior, in this moment, Lord God. Hear the humble cry. And as they are calling upon you, Lord God, do not pass them by. We think that you're not just not passing them by, but you're stopping at their house. You're stopping at their place of need. You're stopping right where they are. And you're saying, I have everything you need. And as they cry out to you, Lord God, we agree with them, Lord God, that the answer comes quickly in Jesus' name. We're not going to dictate how it comes. We're not going to dictate when it comes. We just thank you that it comes and they will testify of the living power and the saving power of Jesus Christ in this moment right now. Thank you, Lord God, for a desperate heart that you desperately want to hear from them in Jesus Christ's name. And we declare it is done in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Let's give God a hand of praise. Let's give God a hand of praise. Thank you, Lord God, for hearing us in our desperation. You guys can have your seats in the presence of God. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Do we have a video? No, so just offering. Oh, this is our first Sunday. First Sunday. Wow, it's already November, and it's our first Sunday. Pastor Ray, no, okay, I got you. So we're gonna take the. Okay, we're gonna take our offering, and we're gonna honor God with our giving. Amen. Is that a good thing? Amen. Amen. Wow. So listen, I know this is one thing we do every day, but we want to remind you that God is faithful to give back to you as you give to him. And actually, there's a scripture in the Bible where the woman who had two mites, the widow who had two mites, she gave in her desperate situation and said, Lord, if you don't bless me with these two mites, I have no other hope but you. And I'm not saying, we are not saying empty your bank accounts or anything crazy like that. We're saying trust God as you give. Trust God as you give. Trust God as you give. Even if you're in a desperate situation, trust God as you give. I want to first also say thank you, thank you, thank you. Pastor Dre made the announcement last week about our legacy campaign. Do you want to share? Yeah, come on, break it down, baby. I'm desperately in love with this girl here. Oh.
He He on one today, y'all. Anybody agree with me? He's just on one today. We gave you guys an update last week. We did open escrow. We did. We said Monday we would, and we did. On the Legacy Pledge campaign, we are at 85%. But we told you last week we had more than enough to open escrow. We're just working on, they want to make sure that we got money, a year's worth of payments in the bank. That's all we're working on now, but we are in escrow. The paperwork literally says to be closed by December 24th as a Christmas gift. So if you're visiting today, we're buying this building. If you're visiting, that's what we're doing. We're buying this building. So amen and hallelujah. What we've been trying to do for 10 years is happening in 90 days. I was talking to Mark yesterday, and how many of y'all, you know, you've heard me preach about suddenlies and immediates, right? But there's usually always what you don't see in the background, right? Music people, actors, they pop up on the scene, and it looks like they just got there, right? They came out of nowhere, but you don't know they've been grinding, right? They've been grinding. They've been YouTubing, they've been doing all the stuff. They've been getting no's and rejections from, you know, auditions and stuff. Well, we've been grinding for 10 years, and it didn't look like we were gonna be able to do it, but it literally, August the 3rd, we made a determination that we were moving forward and we would close for Christmas, amen? So what Pastor Chuck was talking about is, remember, we asked everybody to give a certain amount. If you still wanna do it, you still have time before we close, feel free to do that. You can do it four different ways. You can give online. You can give via text message 84321. You can text that amount. You can do bill pay. You can give today. If you need an envelope, they'll give you an envelope today. You can do all of that. But we're in the middle of it. Amen. And we're really, really excited. And the things that we want to do with this space once it is ours, we've done a lot. We've put like $1 million into the building over time because, you know, y'all, this was an empty warehouse when we moved here. For those of you who were here. But there's so many plans that we have for what God wants us to do to be a continue to be a resource to this community, and we're just excited to get about it, amen? We're excited to get it done. So can you just lift your hands up or your phones or your envelope, whatever you're doing? I just want to pray a blessing over your households. Father, I thank you, Lord God, that you give seed to the sower. I thank you in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord God, that you said in your word, if we would give to you, you would give back to us good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. You would cause men to give into our bosom. And so as we give today, we thank you in the name of Jesus Christ that the return is determined by you, and that we thank you that every need is met. There's no gap, no lack, no holes. I pray for every audition. I pray for every record CD that's dropping. I pray for every writer in the room. I pray for every person looking for a promotion, looking for a job. I pray for every person who needs their rent paid, even though tomorrow is the 8th and it was due on the 1st, that you are a God that can come in right on time, and we thank you for grace in the meantime, in Jesus' name. Be glorified in our houses, and then cause us to be a resource to those in our sphere of influence that we can give out of our overflow in the name of Jesus Christ. So I pray a blessing. I release prosperity in the name of Jesus Christ, not the selfish kind of prosperity, but a prosperity that enhances the kingdom of God, in Jesus' name. To you be the glory for what you've already done and what you're going to continue to do in our lives and in the kingdom of God, in Jesus' name. All God's people, one heart and one mind said together, amen and amen. Give God glory for his faithfulness. Hallelujah. We know, you know, we've been running about an hour and a half. We know we're over that, but that word was good and worth it. Amen? Amen. And so was the worship. We're going to take communion real quick. Pastor Ray's going to come and do that, and then we're going to release you to go home. Amen? Amen, amen.
Thank you, Pastor Jay. Come on, let's give God a praise one more time for that word today. Amen, amen. Today is the day that we set aside, and we talked about this a couple weeks ago about tradition, and we do this every first Sunday, but I want to invite you beyond the first Sunday. I want to invite you to a space where we honor God because we understand and we remember. Amen? This is not a time that is set aside for just once during the month or even once during the year, but we are intentional about this moment because we remember. It is about our gratitude. we are intentional about this time of communion because our remembering is designed to fuel our gratitude for his willingness to stand in our place as the atonement for sins. So today, in this moment, every believer, every person who has accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior should see this moment as our duty to never forget what Christ did for you and for me. Scripture reads in 1 Corinthians 11:23-29, "For I have received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.'" What do we remember? Scripture records what happened that day: the nails in his hands and feet, pierced in his side, the pain he endured for us. We were talking this morning to those who serve and talking about how Jesus saw us even though we weren't in front of him. He died for our sins some 2,000 years later. A lot of us make sacrifices for people that we can see in front of us, people that we hang out with, or people that we are related to every day. But how many of you would be willing to die for somebody you've never seen? I want you to think about that for a second. If somebody said you can save somebody's life, but you'll never know them, would you be willing to give your life for that person? I want to suggest to you that I can answer that question for you and tell you today that you'd probably say no. But look at what Jesus did. He saw each and every one of us and said, "For each and every one of them that are not here, that are not with me at this cross, I'm still willing to give my life. In fact, I have to, in obedience to my Father, who said, 'This is for my obedience to your will.'" And so today, as we prepare to take communion, I want to give you a moment in your gratitude to repent, to allow yourself a moment to say, "God, forgive me. As a vessel that you have created, I want to honor you today. Before I even take of this cup, before I even take this bread, before I even drink of the cup, I want to say thank you." So let's just take a moment here. Bow our heads and repent before God. "God, forgive us for anything that we've committed that is contrary to your word." We take this moment seriously. And as we take communion and say that we remember, we offer ourselves as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable unto you, which is our reasonable service. And in these next moments, I want to give you a chance just to speak to your God. Let's not float past this moment, but see it as the beginning of the rest of this month, as we honor him with our lives, if in our thought lives. Pastor Chuck was talking about desperation, getting back to the moment, to an understanding. You remember how you were that first day when you received the Lord into your heart? Lord, renew that in our hearts in the mighty name of Jesus. And so today, in this moment, we honor you as trophies of his grace and trophies of his mercy. We don't skate past this, but we are intentional about saying thank you right in this very moment. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Thank God. Amen. Can I invite you all to please stand to your feet now as we eat of the bread and drink of the cup? And I want you to say this as a body of believers here and online. Just say this with me. Before you take the bread and drink of the cup, say this: "We remember." Now repeat after me: "God, thank you." Please eat of the bread and drink of the cup. Amen.
Hallelujah. Our God is good, is he not? He is a good God, and he is faithful to us. Have the most incredible week. Find yourself some space. Create some space to be in his presence. Amen. Don't let it just happen on Sunday. But when you wake up in the morning, our first Sunday, when we first had the first church service back at Van Nuys, and I preached the first sermon for Host House, I literally said, when your feet hit the floor, let your mouth open up to God. And I challenged them, I think for the first couple of years, when your feet hit the ground, let that foot hitting the ground be a sign to your mouth and your heart to give him glory. Amen. Can I challenge you to do that this week? Can I challenge you to do that week? And find a place and a space to give God glory. Amen. I'm preaching next week. Again, Mark chapter 8. Go ahead and read it ahead of me. The title is called, Do You Still Not Understand? Jesus says it a few times in this chapter. Do you still not get it? Do you still not understand? It's going to be good. We're going to have a good time. It's going to be upbeat. I saw your faces like, ah, here we go. No, it's going to be good. Amen. I want to thank everybody who wished me a happy birthday, who sent me a text. Thank you so much from the bottom of my heart. I really appreciate it. And then can y'all do me just one favor? Say happy birthday, Lady Vicky. We love you. We appreciate you. And happy birthday to you. This whole church is like a November, like literally November birthdays. Every single solitary day of November, somebody at Hope's House that's part of the core has a birthday. So thank you guys for celebrating us. I almost said grab your neighbor by the hand, but I forgot we can't do that no more. Can't touch this. Just lift your hand to the Lord. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus Christ for your goodness, for your mercy, and for your grace. Thank you for today. Thank you for the word. Help us understand that we, whether we know it or not, we are desperate. We are desperate. And we're desperately in need of your presence, your power, your touch, and your guidance, and your wisdom in Jesus' name. Now say this with me. May the Lord watch between me and thee while we're absent one from another. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You are dismissed. Have an incredible week.
Thank you. once again, we come into your presence with expectancy in our hearts. God, we know you're going to bless us.